Good afternoon, everyone. We want to make a special welcome to all the judges that are joining us from the early morning. And we want to reiterate, we really appreciate your time today and being here. My name is Christian Kerr. I'm joining Keegan Garvin, Paul Mitchell, Katie Finau. Today, we're here to talk to you about the new Tela supply chain for Ferrero Group. So here's the agenda. We're going to walk through a quick roadmap of what we'll discuss today. We'll start with an executive summary, which will cover our high-level recommendations. Then we'll go into those, a little bit of justification and analysis. Move into the risks, and then end with implementation, some concluding remarks, and then open the floor to any questions. So as we first took a look at the case, we saw a lot of underlying issues, but not a lot of root causes. We were wondering, what's the relationship between price fluctuations, supply shortages, and consumer preferences? So if a consumer faces a supply shortage, prices increase, how does that consumer react? Do they switch products? And what we realized was that all of these feed into one idea, which is supply security. And thus, we wanted to focus our recommendations around how can we ensure that we have ample supply, as well as a good cost structure to handle fluctuations. In order to do this, we have three recommendations. The first being backwards integration. Second, diversifying both supply and suppliers. And third, a collaboration program with farmers down at the root level. We recommend purchasing Holtan. We believe that backwards integrating will allow us to capitalize on a lot of supply chain cost reductions, will allow us to absorb price fluctuations and increases in raw materials so that we aren't putting those down on the consumer. Supply diversification, we want to focus on hazelnut in the regions as well as how is our rest of our supply chain looking. We see a lot of risks in our raw materials. And then finally, collaborating at the farm level, helping them to learn best practices, improve their yields, improve their quality so that we can drive this industry forward. And as we put all of these together, we really wanted to focus on was how can we absorb costs so that our consumers are not facing high prices. Now Keegan will discuss backward integration.
Thanks, Christian. So really the backbone of our solution is this backward integration, and that is purchasing Holtan, the supplier, so that we can absorb the supply chain cost fluctuations that we've seen in hazelnuts. As it currently sits, the fluctuation in supply chain is actually detrimental in cost to our end consumers. And how this happens is raw material availability will decrease in the market, and then as a result, suppliers will have to increase their prices on us. And as it traditionally is, we have been then passing on that unit price increase to the end consumer, and that's something that we want to avoid at all costs. So through backward integration by purchasing Holtan, we believe that we'll be able to reduce our overhead and transaction costs, as well as access vital farmer relationships that we previously did not have access to through our supplier, and that's something that Katie will touch on a little bit later as well. We'll also be able to improve our coordination between our supply chain, especially with the then ownership of our actual supplier. And finally, we'll be able to ensure competitive parity within the industry. We actually did a competitor analysis, and we found that other competitors have actually taken on this backward integration approach. So it's something that will keep us competitive within this market. But before we went ahead and decided to propose this solution, we wanted to go through a backward integration acceptance framework. So from McKinsey & Company, they identified four key areas of risk that you had to go through to see whether or not your company is right for backward integration. So the first one is setup cost. We believe that Ferrero is well set to have adequate capital as well as enough asset synergies with Holtan to create a smooth transition. We also, again, why we're here is to reduce those transaction costs and reduce those transaction risks. So by backward integrating, we're able to reduce those price fluctuations and diversify them across now our subsidiary supplier as well as our current Ferrero company so that we don't have to pass them on to the consumer. And finally, we'll be able to improve our coordination effectiveness with a more efficient inventory management as well as better capacity utilization across the supply chain. And what this really boils down to is that supply chain costs and coordination will allow Ferrero to absorb an increase in material costs without actually increasing those prices for consumers. And with that, I'll pass it on to Paul to talk about supply diversification.
Awesome. So as we talked about earlier, the second pillar of our strategy is really tackling the supply diversity issue. We have kind of two approaches to it. One is a supply approach, so supply diversity, and then the second approach is supplier diversity, getting into more suppliers. I'm going to talk a little bit about supply diversity, specifically within the hazelnuts, because that is our most critical ingredient. It goes into many of our products, and that is the one where we're buying the predominant share in the marketplace worldwide. How would we do this? So as we mentioned, we already want to backwardly integrate. Once that's completed, we will own them as a subsidiary. And what we can do is use their resources, use their expertise and knowledge to then establish new hazelnut crops around the world. This helps us increase supply, minimize risk, both for weather and politics, and then it also creates new opportunities for us to capitalize on. Within increasing supply, this is so critical and so important moving forward. As we have seen, other competitors are backwardly integrating. As they do that, they are tightening up the supply of the hazelnut market. This is already a tight market, and we need those supplies going forward. We've already invested in a new plant, signaling that there is strong growth in the marketplace, and we have high confidence that that growth is going to take place. Since it takes many years for a new hazelnut tree to come to maturity, we need to get in on that now so that we have that supply. Looking at weather risk, in this example, we saw how a single frost event can decimate 25% of the worldwide crop of hazelnuts. That's a risk that's absolutely unacceptable for an ingredient that is so critical and important to us. What we need to do is move into other regions, other areas that have similar climates but different weather patterns. So that way a single event, you know, one-time freeze, isn't going to impact us like it did here. Next, we look at political security. So Turkey's generally considered a relatively stable place, but politics happens fast, political unrest happens quickly. And what we've seen, even with the recent coup just last year, things can change on a dime. And like I said, it takes time for those new crops to come to maturity, so we need to invest now for even the remote possibility of something happening later. Otherwise, we'll be putting ourselves in a really bad place if we don't do that. And finally, it creates new opportunities. There are many different types of hazelnuts grown around the world. Different strains, varieties, hybrids are being developed all the time. A great example is in Washington and Oregon State. There's a variety that has a harder hull structure to it. And what that allows is mechanization of harvesting. The current crop that's grown in Turkey has a much softer structure, and so it has to be picked by hand. Hazelnuts, you wait for them to reach maturity before they fall to the ground on their own. You don't take them right off the tree. And so what happens is, if there's like a windstorm or something and a lot of things fall and they're picking them by hand, they're leaving a lot on the ground, it's less efficient, and we already have a tight supply, so we really can't afford to leave a single nut on the ground in this case. So getting into a new market with a new type of strain that can help us mechanize that and be more efficient is critically important. So that's kind of how we want to approach supply diversity within hazelnuts using our backward integration strategy that we talked about. Next, Christian will talk about some of our other key ingredients and how we want to promote supplier diversity.
Thank you, Paul. So as Paul mentioned, we wanted to take a look at the rest of our supply chain and its structure. So if you look at this map, the blue dots represent where we're currently manufacturing and producing product. Now the green dots represent suppliers. So what you're going to see here is a very global supply chain. We have locations on almost every continent, and they're supplying across the world. However, what we see is a lot of risk in the supply chain, as the majority of the products are currently single-sourced, with the exception of sugar. The issue we see with this is, as Paul mentioned, with all those externalities that may happen, such as climate or political unrest. What happens when a supplier goes down? So this isn't now just a hazelnut issue, it's more of an input issue. So what we wanted to do was take a more strategic look at our supply chain and a more regional look at our supply chain. By breaking it into two, we can actually locate new potential suppliers more closer in proximity to our factories. That way Brazil isn't sending inputs all the way to Germany when Nigeria can do that instead. So as you can see, on the left is the North America, South America, Oceania, East Asia. On the right, the rest of the world. We really believe that by diversifying risk and by diversifying our supply base, we can get rid of the possibility of another hazelnut crisis in other inputs. But the one caveat to this that you'll notice is palm oil. So 85% of palm oil comes from Indonesia and Malaysia. The issue we saw here was that diversifying risk there doesn't really give us a win, seeing as when inclement weather hits, it hits both of them. It doesn't really help us. What we also saw was consumer trends away from palm oil. In the EU right now, there are currently lawsuits claiming that palm oil has the carcinogens which are capable of causing cancer. So we see a lot of consumer trends away from that, companies actually pulling product off the shelf. So we think that in the future, palm oil will end up being replaced. And what we want to do is move to a future state where we're dual sourcing all of our inputs, just as Paul had mentioned, including hazelnuts in terms of geographic diversity, so that we can better understand our risk as well. Now Katie will discuss the farmer collaboration.
Thanks, Christian. So the final part of our recommendation revolves around investing at that farm level. We want to create a partnership with our farmers called Ferrero for Farmers, or F4F for short. So it's revolved around four facets, the first one being technology. Like Paul mentioned, we want to utilize that mechanized harvesting equipment at our farm level to increase their yields and also provide more quantity for us. Our second one is an environmental factor. If we can start at the farm level with sustainable practices, we can bring it all the way up through our operations. The third is collaboration. If we can share best practices among farmers from farmer to farmer, we can ensure that we are increasing yields overall within the supply chain. And the fourth is quality. If we're starting with a high quality raw input, we can produce a high quality output for our consumers that they will pay a premium price to purchase. So with our analysis, we have found some risks that we'd like to discuss with you guys. First is the loss of economies of scale due to our supplier diversification. We see this as a medium risk, but it is a short-term increase in our contract pricing. So we're accepting this risk. The second one is that we will be failing to we might fail to integrate our Olson with our operations, but we're gonna have a strong change management process in place to ensure that we are managing that acquisition as it goes. We already acquired 70% of our supply from Olson, so we believe that we have strong working relationships with them. Our third is that we could overspend our capital investment, and that would require additional investment, but if we have strong due diligence before the acquisition, we believe that we can mitigate this risk. So with that comes a five-phase implementation plan. So our first phase is to acquire Olson. This is a short-term solution of an acquisition to guarantee our hazelnut supply for the near future. Our second is farm investments. Like Paul mentioned, we want to build at the farm level and create long-term relationships with farmers to have that new crop production that guarantees our hazelnut supply. Our third is to expand suppliers. Like Christian mentioned, we want to diversify. We want to create that regional, local level of suppliers so that we ensure that we are mitigating the risks. And fourth, the Farmers with Ferrero, F4F, is a long-term social responsibility effort to increase our involvement at the farm level, which Ferrero does value in their operations. Fifth, evaluate. We want to reflect on this whole process as we are going. It's an ongoing process, continuously improving, in order to mitigate those risks of the political, economic, and social aspects that might happen as we move through our supply chain. Christian's going to wrap up for us.
Thank you, Katie. So in conclusion, again, the theme we wanted to touch on was supply security. So we truly believe that these three recommendations by backwards integrating and really finding cost reductions so that we can absorb costs and reduce the fact that we might have to give price increases to consumers, by diversifying both supply and our suppliers to get rid of the risk in our supply chain, and then finally working on the farm level to both grow supply and grow quality supply, we believe that we have the ability to really reduce the probability of unit price increases due to demand or supply fluctuations. And with that, we would love to open the floor to any questions.
Talk a little bit about your implementation timeline. Get a little more into detail on is this all happening at once and like the amount of time and years that it would take.
Can you take that?
Yeah, we take that. So we believe that the first one is really a short term. We're looking for hazelnuts in the next year. So we're looking at like pretty close in the next 12 months. 2, 3, and 4 could really be done simultaneously, concurrently, and we see that as like a 2 to 5 year plan. We talked about certain ones could come faster than others. It just depends on how fast the sourcing organization moves with Ferrero. And then the fifth phase evaluation, we plan to have continuous improvement meetings to make sure that we are meeting the standards, that we avoid the problems in Turkey, the weather issues, things like that, so that we're evaluating throughout our long-term implementation plan.
Any bandwidth concerns? As you look across all of those recommendations, any bandwidth concerns?
Definitely. I think that this is a lot to handle, and we thought that each of these are vital to the overall issue that we saw. We don't really see one of these more important than the other. However, we did try to prioritize them as best we could, and we felt that the third recommendation, the farmer collaboration, would definitely be done more on a long-term scale. We believe that maybe looking towards like a co-op system similar to like what Land O'Lakes would do for farmers. We think that that's more long distance and long-term. We think that right now, most of our bandwidth should be spent on backward integration, as well as working through issues regarding supply. So backwards integration doesn't just give us new supply and we don't have to worry about price fluctuations. So we need to really work towards where are we sourcing the majority of our ingredients as well, to ensure that although we may own whole time next year, what happens if Turkey gets hit again? So we need to ensure that we're diversifying that risk.
Can you talk a little bit about the economics behind backward integration?
So we did a little preliminary financial analysis. Data was a little bit hard to come by. Both companies are privately owned, and there's no 10K to file through to find all the numbers. But what we were able to find is that we do know that Olton is a $500 million business. We do know that 70% of their business comes from Ferrero, so we know about $350 million of that spend is coming from us. And we also know that margins are low. So what we did is we kind of took some approximations, took best guesses to come up with an evaluation, and I'll walk you through that now. So we know that we assumed a 5% margin. We know that commodities is relatively low. And so assuming a 5% margin on Olton's sales, we came up with a $25 million a year profit that they would then be generating. We also feel like a 10% cost savings and synergies is achievable, both because we can eliminate some of those costs, but also because we're already purchasing from them and we have that relationship, and we think that the integration is going to go really well. And so we value that 10% on our spend that we are currently spending on them at about $35 million. So we took those together and we came up with a total of $60 million a year that we believe is achievable in both cost savings, cost avoidance. And we assumed a valuation, and this was a number that we kind of looked at. We figured if their earnings were about $30 million a year, then their if we flip that and look at 30 times their valuation, that would give them a $750 million bid. So that's quite a premium on the bid of acquisition, but we decided, you know, aim high and be safe. And so using that and then looking at our $60 million a year figure in costs that we think we can cut, we believe that you would break even in year 12. However, I do want to stress that the primary reason that we are backwardly integrating is to diversify some of that risk and take some of that risk out. So while financials are very important, they do come in as a close second to that primary goal. And that primary goal is making sure that we always have a supply available of our hazelnuts, because that is the most critical ingredient that's going into our products. And we want to make sure that we have a sustainable and long-term supply of those products.
How does the backward integration ensure that you have a supply of hazelnuts? Because you're not going to be growing it. You basically have the manufacturing capacity. So how does integrating that ensure or reduce risk on hazelnut?
So the way we viewed it, and in a lot of the case and a lot of our research shows, is that they're considered like a producer, so they're one step between us and the farm. They have very strong relationships with farmers. So I know on one of our slides we mentioned what we really liked out of it was by purchasing them and backwards integrating, we also kind of blend into their relationships with farmers. That way we're a little bit closer to them, have a better understanding for what they do, and then leverage those relationships and see if we can diversify both geographically or in other ways. We viewed a very strong advantage of that was being, you know, we view Olton as having very close level, and that's why we also recommended the F4F program, was to strengthen that relationship as well, because we view that if we show farmers how much we care about how they're doing helping them, then that we believe that across the globe, it'll be more likely that we'll be able to diversify and find new sources for these ones.
And just to add on to that, a little bit on what we talked about diversifying the supply. And so once we acquire Olton, we would push that we establish new crops. That could be either sourcing new crops from new farmers, but if we're moving into a region where no one is, where the climate supports hazelnut production, but no one currently doing hazelnut production, Olton would probably be stepping in and doing the production themselves. So we would have some supply base that would be company owned, and some, as Christian said, that we're acquiring through those relationships. Another important thing to note is that Olton, we're currently taking 70% of our capacity, and that's where we're sourcing most of the hazelnuts from. So there is already a little bit of a capacity cushion built in. If we own them, we can say, I'm sorry, you're not selling to competitors, that 30% is ours if we need it. And we can do that because we own them. So that gives us the short term, and then that long term developing the relationships plus potentially owning our own farms in the future kind of secures the long term.
What's the plan for that 30% access if you don't need it?
So that's something else we talked about too. What we thought would be a really good idea is if we don't need it, why not supply it to our competitors but at a premium price? The market is really tight. Prices are going up. Supply is short. Sell it either on contract or, better yet, on the spot market and make some money on it. We're not going to necessarily hold those for our own. Another note on hazelnuts, though, is hazelnuts can be stored for several years if they're properly dried or frozen. So we could also choose to keep those internally at Olton to help mitigate some risk, you know, if there's another freeze in Turkey in a couple years before our new plantations come to maturity, we would still have some sort of a stockpile supply.
Yeah, and I would just add on to that really quick, that capacity cushion that we do have allows us to be a little bit more comfortable with our internal transfer pricing. So we want to make sure that the market stays efficient and we're internally trading between Olton and Ferrero. We'll maintain that, but with that excess 30% capacity, we hope to continue the way that they're distributing that. We'd be
terms of just like a broader recommendation or other, yeah, why did you,
mm-hmm.
I mean, not choose to avoid that?
I don't know.
Right, of course. The first thing we thought of was, you know, they're so expensive, hazelnuts. Let's just use a different nut. Let's just see if we can either do that or find a different mix. The issue we saw with that was consumer preferences are very strong towards hazelnuts. So as you look at Nutella, look at the next 9 or 10 competitors, every single one of them is a hazelnut spread because the color profile and taste profile is so distinct. So that was something we didn't really want to do. We also thought about forward integrating, so maybe moving in more into distribution, so maybe we can handle our logistics a little bit more efficient than the companies that we're employing to do it. We didn't do that as a competency for us. We're more in just the brand name, so I don't really know the Ferrero brand name would carry much against like a C.H. Robinson or something like that. But those are just two that we sussed through.
And on that forward integration point, while we were considering that option, we actually found that in 2011, we have a strategic distribution alliance with Hershey in the North American region. So what that means is their core competency is more on the forward integration part, that being logistics and distribution of the actual product. Both us and Hershey realized that we don't compete on inventory and warehousing. That's not something that we need to worry about in terms of competitive, any sort of competitive consideration. And so we hope to continue to leverage that relationship with Hershey on that forward integration portion. But actually, not actually doing it ourselves.
Did you consider a similar relationship with Alton as you have with Hershey?
We definitely thought of not Olton, we actually looked into competitor analysis. So could we work with even like Calibo, so that's another confectionery company, recently did the same thing a couple years ago. They bought a nut producer, or a nut farm, or producer, sorry. And we thought about, well, could we, since we're not competing with them, as Keenan said, on inventory logistics, could we work with them in terms of warehousing? However, what we viewed was, you know, we felt that our demand and supply was so strong, or at least the demand was so strong, that inventory wasn't like a huge consideration for us. You know, this case wasn't much of having too much supply and wondering, are we going to have stockouts or are we going to have too much inventory? It was more, we have the demand, we just simply don't have the supply. So therefore, warehousing was a less focus for us.
If others weren't reverse integrating for the nuts, and you still, obviously, weather unpredictable, uncontrollable is a factor, would you have a different recommendation? I mean, is what's driving, I guess, your recommendation that, in addition to the weather things, that the patterns that we can't control, we're seeing others react in a way that they're acquiring based on the market? Mm-hmm. Is that possible?
I don't think our recommendation would be substantially different. Really, when we took all the, kind of as Christian laid out, we called them symptoms of the case that were kind of very surface level, it really all boils down to that supply risk. And so that's really where it is at. Keeping up with competitors is definitely important. We talked about the making sure we're on a competitive parity with them. But the real driving factor is that we want to make sure we have total control over such a critical ingredient. Ferrero alone buys 25% of all hazelnuts. There are very few companies that buy a supply in that quantity across the globe, and so it's really about the risk that's most important. So even if our other competitors weren't doing it, I would say our framing would maybe shift from we should do it because it's a good idea, now we have to do it because our competitors are doing it, to our competitors aren't doing it, we're still the biggest, it's still going to give us great advantages, so we should do it to give us an edge on them. So I wouldn't necessarily say that the way it is now, we're not necessarily getting the edge on our competitors, we're keeping up with them, but regardless, the supply risk is still the primary thing that we're concerned with here.
And I would just say really quickly too, if you were to ignore the externalities, the hazelnut market is such that there are so few suppliers and so many large conglomerate confectionery companies that are vying for the supply, that it's really advantageous, just given the market conditions, to backward integrate to secure that supply, again, to reduce that risk. Regardless of the externalities that come into play.
You had talked about essentially that the global regionalization sounded like it was mostly toward securing supply for not only hazelnuts but others. Any insights on the financial implications of that?
We wanted to take a look at the logistics and kind of, but we weren't sure how far down the rabbit hole we wanted to go with that. We figured that, and as with the hazelnut recommendation, we really wanted to focus on the risk portion, and that, you know, although it may, let's say it's not exactly a financial gain, maybe it's a net equal, but the risk advantage itself is worth it.
To add on to that, just looking at some of the financials, hazelnut, there's not a plethora of reports about hazelnuts. We were lucky to find this one done by Oregon State. And they found that it is pretty economical, actually, to start production of hazelnuts. It's not necessarily a huge investment. It's about $2,100 an acre. And it pays off by year. Well, it depends on what you're planting. So if you're planting like a single year crop, year nine, you're planting what they call a double density crop, which is just twice as many plants in the same area. It pays off in year seven. And there are some significant payoffs to that double density as well.
When you talk about using the hazelnuts that are mechanically farmed, did you look at the difference in those nuts and the impact it could have to the product?
That's definitely a risk we discussed. One thing we did talk about, though, is if you look at the global source of nuts, it's like 80% comes from Turkey, and they're all that one variety. So regardless, even